Good morning and good afternoon, good evening to those who joined us from other time zones. I'm happy to know that more than 350 participants from 10 different countries have joined today in this webinar. So on behalf of Institute of Rural Management, Anand, and the organizing committee of the centenary celebration of Dr. Varghese Kurian, I extend you all a hearty welcome to this webinar. IRMA, this year, this is a special year for all of us at IRMA, as we are celebrating the centenary of our founder, Dr. Varghese Kurian, who set up IRMA in 1979 with a mission of having a professional managers to serve farmers and the rural poor. Of all the magnificent institutions built by Dr. Kurian, IRMA was, according to many, closest to his heart. The institution from the beginning has set its mission as to promote sustainable, ecologically friendly, equitable socio-economic development of the rural people. The institute, we are happy to say that 40 batches have already graduated. And IRMAns, as they are called, are spread across the globe, working at various levels as leaders and influencers. The current event is one of the many planned as part of the Kurian's centenary celebration. The centenary is planned around two major themes, and the events are going to be spreaded over next couple of months. The themes are organization, governance, and management of collective enterprises in rural areas, and rural management in a post-COVID world. Faculty at IRMA have been involved in research on producers collective with rural organizations and are working with like-minded rural management and development institutions to review, take stock, and plan ahead for the discipline of rural management with evidence of increasing inequality and poverty post-COVID. We are happy to partner with the International Cooperative Alliance, ICA, for the event today that will help us rethink Dr. Kurian's legacy in contemporary times. It is my pleasure to introduce Sri Balu Iyer, the Regional Director for International Cooperative Alliance, Asia Pacific, and is also an alumnus of the 8th batch of IRMA. ICA is the apex organization for cooperative worldwide that advances the cooperative's social enterprise model and provides a global voice and forum for cooperatives. His project experience across Asia extends the area of cooperatives, business association, water, food security, women empowerment, and economic development. Balu serves as the administrator for the Domus Trust and is on the steering committee, World Cooperative Monitor, and was part of the team that co-founded the Global Women's Leadership Network. Balu Iyer will be co-moderating the session today. Joining him will be Professor C. Sambuprasad, who is coordinating the Kurian Centenary Celebration at IRMA. He is a faculty of the Strategic Management and Social Science area, whose research interest includes managing collective enterprises, social entrepreneurship, rural livelihood, public system management, and sustainable transitions. He helped found IRMA's incubator for rural, social, and collective enterprises, and serves on the board of few non-profit and also mentor to social enterprises. He was part of the expert committee to recommend the Department of Agriculture's policy on promoting and scaling farmer producers organizations in the country, and also co-edited a book, Farming Futures, Emerging Social Enterprise in India. I once again welcome you to the event and hope you will join us in Rethinking Kurian, Changing Dimensions of Cooperative and Collectives. Thank you. Over to you, Professor Sambu.
Thanks a lot, Professor Dash, for the warm words of welcome and introduction to the moderators. It's a pleasure to be hosting a set of speakers today. The panelists have wide experience in, you know, managing collective enterprises, being involved in ideas of cooperation almost ever since they graduated from IRMA. So I just wanted to start by indicating the way we plan today's event. We intend having this as a flowing conversation, and each of the panelists will probably have three rounds of discussions between me and Balu, who will be moderating this session. And we hope to have some time for question answers as well. So given the webinar format that we have, we encourage all of you to feel free to share your questions or queries to either a specific panelist or to the whole panel in the chat box. It may be difficult for us to ensure that all of you are able to actually join and speak. Therefore, please use the chat as much as possible. If it is indeed possible, maybe one or two of us might be invited to speak. But we would like to take as many questions as possible. And we have amongst us today, from a preliminary indication of our, the participants list, we have people who are just joining a program of rural management, either at IRMA or at the Xavier School of Management, or there are also many people from the Madras School of Social Work and probably many others. We have development and professionals as well, and academics from across India and the world. So a warm welcome to all of you again. And what I'd like to do is taking this theme, just a little bit about this theme. So what we would like to present through these conversations, and this is one of many that have been happening at IRMA since December, is to present a slightly different face of what we understand as collective enterprises and cooperatives. So often they have a very negative connotation, certain cases ridden with corruption. We see them in the news for the wrong reasons. We also have now a new thrust of the Government of India through the formation of the Ministry of Cooperation. So IRMA has led some of these initiatives by trying to focus perhaps on a slightly different aspect, which we call producer collectives. It started with Dr. Kurian's work with the dairy cooperatives through Operation Flood. And we had a very interesting conversation a couple of days back with some of the leading lights of Operation Flood, Thomas Carter, Aneja, and Shailendra Kumar. And taking it beyond into agriculture, into non-forest timber produce, working with tribals, working with women, working with artisanal collectives and so on. So our panelists bring a rich set of experiences on this. So I'd like to start the conversation by inviting each one of them, and I will briefly introduce the panelists when they are speaking. We're going to start with Emmanuel Murray. Emmanuel is a well-known figure to many of us. I think he's otherwise referred to as one of the most cooperative person on the LinkedIn platform. I think he has exceeded the quota of number of people who could join and like him. So Emmanuel is a member of is a graduate of IRMA from the second batch of IRMA. And after working for a few years in the National Dairy Development Board's Vegetable Oil Project, he joined NABARD, where he served in various capacities for over 25 years. And he has a wide exposure across several Indian states and had a stint on deputation with India's Central Bank, the Reserve Bank of India, as well. During this period, he has led various community-based development programs, including work on SHGs, watersheds, and tribal development, and has vast experience in working with grassroots institutions. So he took an early retirement from NABARD, and he worked for 5 years with Manavia Development and Finance Limited and the Indian subsidiary of the Dutch cooperative impact investor Oiko Credit, leading the debt operations. He currently works as a senior advisor at Caspian Impact Investment Advisors, supporting ecosystem development for agri startups and farmer producer organizations. So he's considered one of the foremost authorities on the FPO movement in India as a thinker, mentor, and funder. He writes extensively on agriculture and rural credit and related subjects. And I would encourage many of you to follow him on LinkedIn. So Emmanuel had already started a series of short pieces in his LinkedIn post, remembering Kurian. So in this first round, we would like you to all share with us briefly in the next 5 minutes, your direct experience in some cases with Dr. Kurian, which many of us have not been fortunate to have. And how did this interaction or the atmosphere in the early stages inspire you and take you further in your work? And if you have some personal anecdote about having interacted with Dr. Kurian, please do share. But you know, you may have rich experiences, but within about 5 minutes. Over to you, Emmanuel.
Okay, thanks so much, Professor Shambhu. It was a surprise for me to be invited to be one of the speakers on this event. Haven't been a very visible person for many years, but thanks so much. And let me talk about the first time I met Dr. Kurian or had a chance to listen to him was when he came to Hyderabad to sign the MOU with the government of Andhra Pradesh for converting the dairy corporation into a federation, into a cooperative federation. After which he had a public lecture, which I attended, and it was very inspiring. Subsequent to that, a year down, the IRMA application process happened, admissions process, and I too applied, along with, of course, many other management schools. And there were more than, I think, 30,000 applicants in that year to the institute. And there were just about 50 seats available. So it was just a lottery of sorts. But fortunately, I made it to the interview. And then, of course, the passion and the drive that we knew of Dr. Kurian and his Operation Flood took me into the being one of the top 40 who got admitted in our batch. And I think the thing about the batch and us as I speak is that while cooperatives, or let's say the Amul pattern, was never indoctrinated into us, it was a constant discussion and debate among us about what is rural management. So all of us used to be, and I think it continues to be, a debate of what is rural management. But the compared to, let's say, 10 years in a school where so many of us studied together, or 3 years in a college, the 1.5 years in IRMA has built a bond with the institution and with IRMANs, which is much stronger than we have with either our school or the college with which we graduated. That is, I think, the power of this institution called IRMA that influenced us. Irrespective of where we worked, we carried the values, the system, the influence that Dr. Kurian had on us, which continues to remain with us. And I think one thing that I could talk about is the movie Manthan. It used to keep being shown in the auditorium every afternoon to the farmers. And while we used to go back from our classes in the diagnostic lab, we would often drop into and sit in the auditorium and watch the movie. So maybe we watched it 100 times over. And almost, you know, the dialogues where we learned them by heart. And those used to be things we again used to discuss about things like how society, apni hai, you know, the Nasiruddin Shah's famous dialogue, and those sort of things, and how the cooperative worked against the forces of the private vendor who was being different. So although it was dramatically presented, it had a deep influence on our own value systems. So I'll just stop with a small narrative about my personal experience with Dr. Kurian. So when I joined NDDB after graduating, we had issues with the oilseeds cooperatives not getting working capital, because there were restrictions on of what are called selective credit controls. So organizations could not hold more than required stocks of oil seeds because they were considered sensitive commodities. And then we wrote to the RBI that these are farmers' institutions, so they should be exempted from these kind of regulations. And the RBI referred the case to NABARD. And then a senior team from NABARD came to NDDB, and perchance I joined NABARD later, but perchance I was deputed to escort the team around on their visit. And then they wanted to meet Dr. Kurian at the end of their visit. And he said that I am only an honorary chairman of this organization, so I would not like to meet these guys. You can meet the secretary, Mr. Aneja, and that's it. And you know, he, Dr. Kurian, had a way of dramatizing things. And so he kind of met these guys. You know, these guys were worried that if we go back and tell the chairman NABARD or the governor RBI that we couldn't meet Dr. Kurian, it would be embarrassing for them. And he, as soon as he met them, he fired them and said that I will go and beg for my farmers in foreign lands if you guys don't fund these federations. And that influenced the decision, and we could get relaxation very quickly for the cooperatives regarding selective credit control, which was a restriction on working capital to these federations. So that was one of the direct, I think, influences where I was part of this whole thing. So with that, I'll give a break.
Thanks a lot, Emmanuel, for sharing how you got into it. So you might have been one of the few who listened to Kurian before actually entering IRMA. Your stint there, what you took back from there, and your immediate response. We will hear more about your own work with collectives and cooperatives a bit later in the round, next round. So I'd like to now move next to Vijay Spita, who perhaps, unlike the other panelists, may not have had a direct interaction with Kurian, or maybe she didn't. Because she is she founded Chitrika in 2005 to pursue her interest in the craft sector, and has continued her association with crafts ever since. So as the CEO of Chitrika, she's, for the past 13 years, she's been involved in promoting artisanal collectives. Her primary focus is on creating new economic opportunities for artisans by ramping up their business administration technology skills in managing producer enterprises. She leads the Chitrika team in honing their capacities to provide impactful services to craft communities. Chitrika is now part of the Access Livelihoods Group and has been working with artisans since 15 years. It's expanded its vision to work with farmers and other marginal communities in developing sustainable value chains via vis-a-vis enterprises. So, Smita, you probably already joined IRMA with the legacy of Kurian all around, and maybe after, you know, a few years of the institution, there might have also been a certain level of skepticism with regard to how this institution is there, what its interface with the market is, and so on. So, what's your kind of recollection of your time possibly at IRMA, and what kind of made you to continue with, the sector, so to speak? It doesn't have to be the dairy sector, but cooperatives. So was there a certain kind of influence of Dr. Kurian, or was it spoken about a lot? Obviously, you didn't see the Manthan film 100 times, maybe only 3, 4, or 5 times. I'm not sure how much. So, you know, a decade or more after, how did this influence of Dr. Kurian and this idea of working with cooperatives impact your own thinking?
Okay. Yeah. Good morning to all. Yeah. Since I had certain things to say, but you started asking me a few things. Actually, I think when we were kids, Manthan used to be telecasted in Doordarshan as a smaller series, I think. And I might have seen it for less number of times, but a lot has been ingrained, and even I have shown it to my son twice. So yeah, I joined IRMA because application fee was 200 rupees. Because other XLRA, IIMs where it was like 1,200, 1,500. And I used to give tuitions to earn that money for gathering money for whatever cat coaching, Irma coaching and all that. So I didn't know who was Kurian. And like a typical middle class person with higher aspirations, so since I didn't get a seat in XLRI, then okay, Irma chala try kar lete hain, because I didn't do well in the interview. So 200 we paid, we did the test, and I went. I liked the campus, and I didn't know anything about Kurian. Then somebody told me the highest paying job in the campus is GCMMF. Man chale jao, highest pay. So I went in. So you have this first ranker syndrome. Chalo placement mein kaisa bhi GCMMF mein chale jaate hain. So this is how I joined Irma. I didn't know anything about Kurian. 2 years, and in 2 years I didn't know much about Kurian. But one course we had by Professor Raju by Development Interventions. So in which I chose to understand critique an organization called Tribhuvan Das Foundation. So at the time I had met the former CEO, I think. I don't remember the name of that lady. So we had very interesting conversation. So only one line I wrote, which actually warranted a presentation before Kurian, because I said Kurian thought it is just one more feather in his cap, something like that I had written. So what all I had written, I don't remember, but it seemed really like Abel Mujemar kind of thing, which I have written. So Raju said, it's very nice. So let me arrange a presentation with Dr. Kurian. So I was very scared because Kurian has certain kind of an image, and he'll have a lot of questions. And Professor Raju also said, put a lot of numbers, and the numbers about an organization which I didn't know. So all of it. So all in all, it was a very tense presentation. I didn't know what happened. I don't remember what happened. I don't know what he spoke. And I don't remember what he spoke. So that has been my interaction with one personal interaction, because I was the only one giving the presentation. So Professor Raju, Dr. Kurian, I think Mr. Joseph was there. So that is how the presentation went on. So later I did my field work in Gujarat. Okay, I got exposed to lots of crowds. So in Irma, basically, you need to choose between development and non-development wala, right? So I chose crafts because it seems very beautiful. Okay, sorry to say, but it seemed like all women think women like beautiful things. So let's get into crafts. So that was the reason why in Irma, I got placed whatever, but immediately I left the job and started working on crafts. But after 6 months in the field, I just wanted to run away without reservation. I ran off from Srikakulam and came back. So basically it was a very ugly craft value chain, is extremely ugly. So the beauty got shattered, and now entered into the ugliness. So till then, I didn't know Kurian. Okay, and after that, some chances to read his autobiography. It's by his, I think it's his biography. And yeah, lot of reading, interactions and all, whatever my understanding about Kurian, this thing has been, and lot of reflection has been after out of Irma and after 2-3 years out of Irma. And yeah. So basically, if I have to, through my interaction, my learning has been very less, but I will talk about it from a regular person who don't know Kurian. From that kind of perspective, if I look at the campus, actually the campus of Irma actually is what is actually world class. It's quality, because I also feel that poor should not be served poorly, right? So Kurian envisioned an institution where actually the best of minds with the highest quality has to work on the most difficult problem of poverty. I think the vision of Irma, the curriculum, how it has created, I have read through all of it. So I think that's something which is path breaking, where now the mainstream management institutions are now talking about a lot of combining social, all of it, because it's going in one direction. I think my first takeaway has been that the poor should not be served poorly. It requires the highest of minds. So I think I incorporate it a lot when we are working in our own organizations, where, so we have people from Irma, NIFT, NID and all of it. So whenever we hire and look at the best of professionals from the field and non-degree professionals who are from, say, the community, the weavers, need not have a degree, but who are professionals. So the second point I'm coming to is his own definition of professional. He says a professional means a person who professes commitment to the cause. So I think that definition has guided me a lot. So my own definition of degree or no degree, but definitely should have technical caliber and the commitment. So the professionalism and the integrity. So that definition has actually guided me throughout in my 17 years of work. And my most important third learning from Kurian and later also from CBF has been cooperatives are business enterprises, because they say cooperatives are a solution, people should come together and things will happen. No, I think Kurian is the first person where a cooperative as a firm, as a legal entity, and he worked across the value chain. I mean, it's very important to actually strengthen the business. I think that has always guided me that the business also has to be strong. He worked across the value chain. So that also...
Vijaya, I think we will get back to you where you could elaborate some of these thoughts much more. I mean, one thing that you clearly mentioned was that the poor need not be served poorly. And the second point is that comes out is that, you know, Kurian's legacy exists even beyond the campus, across different kinds of organizations. The spirit of the nature of working and some of the ideas that you mentioned about, you know, cooperatives as business enterprises is something that has pervaded many parts and inspired many people. So thank you very much.
So one more point I just want to add, sir.
Yes, yes.
The last point is that actually even the way, even the BTEC way it is conveyed, the importance given to practicum where the students are actually made to clean the dairy after the day's work. They're not just as interns, the machinery and not just the dignity of labor. There is a dignity of labor and also there is a practical aspect to the course that is there, like how it's students of, I think, other dairies also. So I had interaction with Vidya Dairy. So when I look at, so that's also an important learning which we had integrated with dignity of labor and all the professionals in Chitrika, whether from NID, NFT, they work with the community. Every year, twice annually, they do the stock checking along with the community. So all of these, some of the aspects also, I think, are not directly, indirectly, we have learned by incorporating. Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks a lot, Vijaya. So our third panelist is D. Narendranath. He's currently the executive director of Pradhan. It's one of the premier voluntary organizations in India. Members of founders of the Pradhan were also involved in the review of IRMA at some point. And this connection of this idea of the professional is something which is ingrained in the understanding or the acronym of Pradhan as well. So Naren joined Pradhan 32 years back. So Pradhan is a pioneering organization in India that has contributed significantly to evolving ideas and programs around rural livelihoods and women's empowerment. The work done by Narendranath and colleagues in the late 80s paved way for the emergence of the self-help group movement, which is now the center of all development programs in India. As a field professional in Pradhan in Jharkhand and Rajasthan, Narendranath organized rural women in SHGs and implemented several livelihood programs. These all precede the National Rural Livelihood Mission. As the program director in the resource and research center in Pradhan, Naren was involved in bringing in a number of national and international research and documentation efforts to build the knowledge from practice and make it available in the public domain. I think the newsletters of Pradhan are a great repository of insights and information that many of us can draw upon. Narendranath later set up the National Resource Center for Livelihoods in Pradhan for influencing and informing the design and implementation of the flagship development initiatives of the government, such as NRLM and Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, and facilitating policy dialogues. He lives in Noida with his wife and a daughter. So Naren, welcome to the panel and your reflections on meeting Kurian before, during, and after IRMA.
Hello, audible?
Yes, yes.
Thank you, Shambhu, for such a generous introduction. And welcome to all my co-panelists and all the participants in this very important event. And we're all trying to remember Dr. Kurian. So how has Dr. Kurian influenced us? How does he inspire us and how has he inspired me? I think every cup of milk I drink in the morning or have that butter on a piece of bread reminds me of you know, the whole Operation Flood and that white revolution. And you know, since I've been, I know what's happened, how the milk reaches to this my household in Noida. It must be from some remote corner, maybe in Uttar Pradesh or even in Gujarat, who knows. I get Amul milk, by the way. So that, since I know the travel, you know, suddenly that flashes in my mind. And that is something which I think Dr. Kurian realized and obviously made us realize all later, the power of the small farmer and how the power across millions of farmers, how they can be integrated together. And, you know, it can actually promote, I mean, it can actually present world-class, industry class products to in ordinary people. So this is a kind of thought that occurs to me. I mean, I'm sure a lot of people who have gone through the IRMA system, etc., remember this. So that keeps inspiring me, and that is at a very personal level, at a philosophical level. But to draw from that, you know, Dr. Kurian's implicit faith in the power of the small farmer and their collectives. So I think he's called the dairy man of, you know, India or the world or whatever. But I think he's more should be known as a cooperative man, and he's a people's man. And so he was the one who really implicitly understood the power of the collectives. And this is where my first, you know, kind of an instant of when I remember him. In fact, he was a chairman when we were in IRMA. So I'm also an IRMA. So. You know, so when I was in campus, he was our chairman. And so once in a while, he used to come. It was very busy, the 87, 89 period, extremely busy. The NDDB and the dairy industry, et cetera, doing, you know, at its peak. So I don't think he had enough time to attend to everything. But once in a while, I think IRMA was his passion. So he used to be there in campus. So one, there was an international conference. I don't remember the details on dairy cooperatives and, you know, which he used to host, and he was there. And that was a time, this late 80s, when the whole talk about de-licensing dairy industry and, you know, de-license, taking it out of the cooperative system and opening it up to the open general, which later happened in 91. But so those discussions were happening, and I remember he was very passionate when he spoke in that meeting at the IRMA auditorium. And I still remember the last sentence he said as he walked out his speech and went back to his seat, obviously, that, you know, I will not allow de-licensing of this dairy industry. If it happens, it will be over my dead body. So that was the power, and it was a very powerful speech. I don't remember all the words in the speech in sense, but I remember the power that he packed and the passion that he packed in his speech, that he was so passionate about people's collectives, and he did not want that to be. And he was very clear in his mind that this is, it's got power, it's very powerful, it can compete with any of the best industries or the private sector industries. But at the same time, it exists in the people's space. It does not exist neither in the government space nor in the private sector space. So I need to protect it from both. And I think till his last breath, he kept fighting this battle of protecting the cooperative space, the people's space, being taken over by either the government or the politicians or the private sector. He wanted to protect the dairy industry, the cooperative dairies from the private sector. He said, let them go and open up new dairies in Mizoram or some other place where NDDB hasn't reached. Why do they want to come to the same places where I have, you know, over 40 years, 30 years, our farmers have built this movement. So that is one thing, I think, the implicit faith and the space of the people's collectives and what is the kind of, you know, the protection that it requires. That realization, and I think that continues in our Pradhan's work even now, where we work necessarily through people's collectives. I mean, we don't work through individual farmers or individual artisans, anything. So the big belief in the collectives part. And second, I think the statement that Vijaya made and which you picked up, you know, poor people do not need to be served poorly. It was made in one of those, he maybe made it many times, but in one of the meetings that I was there, I think it was orientation to our batch or our junior batch, I don't remember, where there was this question about there was a question that, you know, IRMA has such a swanky campus and it's hardly anything like the rural realities that you talk about or you show in these movies, etc. So isn't there a contradiction in these two? Why do we need such a, you know, high class, world class campus, whereas the people from here should be actually living in an ashram way, and, you know, they should be going and serving the very poor. And then he said this, you know, you don't have to be poor to serve the poor. So I didn't understand much of it at that point of time. But again, realizing it later that, you know, what you require is not necessarily where you come from, but do you have that empathy to work with the poor people? So you're technical, you may be a great professional. Surely you need to be technically qualified, as Vijay said, the best mind. But at the same time, do you also have the heart? So do you have that empathy with the poor people, which is what is actually most important in a development professional? Again, another, when we define professional in Pradhan Shambhu, as you said, we talk about people who are people with head and heart. So the idea of Pradhan, in fact, is about the people with head and heart going working directly. So using their knowledge and using that and being empathetic to the very poor, and then, you know, whatever, facilitating change. So that is another very personal instance that I have of memory of Pradhan. And obviously, being from Irma was my personal gateway to rural development. I also from, in fact, in spite of being from Kerala and having used Milma milk back home, I wasn't pretty much fully aware of Dr. Kurian and his universe. You know, we have kind of heard of him, but really didn't know what and he and his personality and the larger world he had created. But then, so to me, Irma was that gateway, which we led me to Pradhan and to rural work. So there are many multiple ways in which, you know, I think I connect with Dr. Kurian and his ideals.
Thanks a lot, Naren, for reflecting on this important idea of people's space and the cooperatives occupying and need to be seen as part of the people's space. Our last panelist for this round is Vivekanandan. Vivekanandan was born in 1958 and has the special distinction of being from the first batch of Irma. So I presume you had several interactions with Dr. Kurian in your first year and soon after. Your convocation itself was very special in front of probably 40, 50,000 farmers and when the Prime Minister had graced the occasion as well. On graduating from Irma, he didn't join the dairy cooperatives, but joined the South Indian Federation of Fishermen Societies, or SIFS, at Trivandrum in 1982, which at that time was a very nascent organization of small-scale fishermen trying to intervene in fish marketing and input supplies. He stayed on in SIFS for nearly 26 years, mostly as its chief executive, providing leadership to the development of a wide range of services to small-scale fishermen of Tamil Nadu and Kerala, fish marketing, manufacturing of small boats, supply of outboard motors, credit and insurance, R&D in fishing technologies, etc. SIFS is widely recognized as one of the most successful economic organizations of small-scale fishermen in developing countries. After stepping down from SIFS in 2008, he set up FishMark, or Fisheries Management Resource Center, to take the SIFS experience to new geographies and for new initiatives in managing fish resources and enhancing livelihoods of women fish vendors. FishMark is currently part of Vritti Livelihood Center. The current focus of FishMark is the women fish vendors in major coastal cities in India. Vivek is also closely associated with marine fishing communities across the Indian coast and has also worked as an expert with the FAO and the government of Tamil Nadu. So Vivek, many, many memories of Dr. Kurian, I'm sure. And you will also have a personal, perhaps you had a quarrel about why didn't you join dairy and you went to fish. You would probably like to narrate some of those experiences and what kind of inspiration he has been to your own work in the fishery sector. Over to you, Vivek.
Thank you, Professor Shambhu. I think you are right in saying that being from the first batch gave us a lot more opportunity to meet Dr. Kurian when we were students. And I was also lucky to keep meeting him on and off after leaving Irma. And there are, of course, many experiences, many anecdotes I can share. But I will say a few things, share what I would like think is most interesting and relevant for this audience. The first batch, Irman, we had a number of controversial internal debates and discussions among ourselves and with the faculty and with the management, which directly or indirectly meant Dr. Kurian. One was this whole three-year bond that we had to serve in the so-called designated organizations after finishing the degree. And then we also had a very severely restricted placement system where the organizations invited to participate in the very first batch placement were only from the NDDB and its associates. Basically, the idea was the dairy sector and the oil sector, which was being served by NDDB, gets the first access to Irman's. And since at that point in time, the notional numbers of people required for the so-called underserved sector of rural sector was in thousands and hundreds of thousands, just some 44 of us graduating was seen as a very precious commodity that had to be rationed. And the first access was to NDDB and its own set of organizations. And I was the only person who actually could get out of that sector, get out of the NDDB set of institution and get placed in a rank outsider organization and through the official placement process. And that was something very unique. But even that, there is an important Kurian dimension to that, and that I'll explain quickly. So I this South Indian Federation of Fishermen Society was literally a startup from Trivandrum, turned up for the placement. And the story behind it is very peculiar because so many organizations had shown interest, including government organizations and various kinds of organizations. And they were all rejected entry. And our very first director of IRMA, Dr. Murthy, at least according to the belief we have in our batch, resigned and left the institute only because he felt that the placement should be widened. The menu and the options available for students should be much more than NDDB. So the entry of SIFS was a surprise to all of us. But the story behind it is the SIFS origin of this fishermen's cooperative organization in Trivandrum went back to the 70s in a village called Marianad in Trivandrum, where under a church project, small-scale fishermen got organized to fight the auctioneer or the middleman who controlled the beach auctions of fish. They rebelled against them, formed their own cooperative, and took over the beach sales, and over a period of a few years became a very strong village organization, which fishermen decided their own policies on market. They even directly made contact with export companies for export. So it was the first of the network. It became a model in the fisheries sector. And the people involved in that program, the lay people, they were not priests. They had once, because this cooperative seemed to have some publicity in certain circles. And in the late 70s, Dr. Kurian, on one of his trips to Kerala, sought a visit to this group. So sometime in the late 70s, he spent a day in that village, having a lunch with this group, looked at the fishermen, talked to them, tried to understand what was happening. And then he invited this set of activists to visit NDDB and AMUL, which they promptly did. So two of them visited NDDB and they went to some of the Gujarat cooperatives and came back and had a personal debriefing session with them, which is somewhat of a rare luxury or an impossibility even during the times we were there. And there are many interesting discussions they seem to have had and many disagreements also. So he told these people who are activists, you go back to Kerala and do your revolution. I am doing what I am doing. So they sort of seem to have disagreed at the end, eventually. This group and subsequently organized 10-12 cooperatives and formed a federation which they gave the grand name of South Indian Federation of Fishermen Societies, and were looking for a marketing manager and wanted a professional. So they wrote a letter to Dr. Kurian personally saying, please help us with a marketing manager. Dr. Kurian, without any comment, seems to have passed on this letter to Tushar Shah, who was not only our PRM coordinator, but also our placement coordinator. And Tushar Shah, in his own wisdom, decided that this is a recommendation from the chairman to invite SIFs for the placement. And he did that. Nobody objected, fortunately, and this happened. So even though I left the so-called Kurian Empire and decided to go far away, the farthest one could go from Anand, that was Trivandrum at that point in time, if not Kanyakumari, which is also an area where I worked. Eventually, it turns out that the Kurian influence was always there sometimes, even in that thing. And as soon as I landed, I found that the cooperatives there were screening Manthan, and I was asked to give a translation of all the dialogue in English, which somebody translated into Malayalam. So the influence of Kurian in the formation of the fishermen cooperative societies with which I have been associated for so many years now, also there is a strong link to Dr. Kurian personally. So Kurian's influence and importance is something far beyond what anybody can imagine in this country. So that is something amazing. And for a person like me who worked in the sector where we are organizing primary producers, forming producer organizations, the gold standard for producer organizations still remains AMUL. And the institutions that Dr. Kurian created for the producers, the AMUL itself, the Gujarat Cooperative Milk Marketing Federation, and the NDDP, a promotional organization providing a sectoral leadership. These remain a kind of a reference point, which we always have to revisit and relook. So the last 39 years, ever since I left IRMA, I have always been thinking and rethinking Dr. Kurian and his work and institutions. I'll stop with that.
So just a quick follow-up, Vivek. I mean, did you have opportunities to interact with him after you left Anand? Any brief encounters that you had or conversations that you had or sure. Disagreements?
Yes, I mean, in a sense, it's difficult to argue with Dr. Kurian. So we are too small to, or he feels too small to argue with him. And we don't know. We are in awe of him. So there is a barrier there. But having said that, the very first year after IRMA, and in my very early 1 year of work with this small organization, made me desperate to get, though they were very good friends, a lot of good activists, wonderful company, everything, the need to find one more professional to work with me. So I came to IRMA in search of, for the second year placement. Of course, didn't get anybody, that's another story. And then sought an appointment with Dr. Kurian, just as a courtesy call, a little bit of wariness. I got it very easily. He spent a little bit of time with me. And it was very interesting. A few things he tried to understand what I was doing. Who was behind us? You want to know who? Who are your donors? So I said, I knew that, AMUL had a great link with Oxfam. And my first salary came from Oxfam donation. So I told Oxfam, so that pleased him very much. Then he told me the importance of standardization. And so I told him, we are working this thing, there are set network of village co-op. This is important for you is to standardize your operations. The way we, Anand Pattern cooperatives are so standardized in there, from the milk testing to the operations, everything is standardized. So he told me the import of standardization. The next thing he talked about scale. He asked me, okay, how big a project can you give me? So I was just struggling to make sense of these 10 village organizations, which I was sort of trying to, manage and run at that point in time. There's no way I could have given a sectoral projection and an op-flood type of a project to Dr. Kurian. But that's what he expected. Whether he really expected, I don't know, or it was only his way of pushing me to think big. And he talked about something that he had done very early on, which was so big with so many extra zeros in terms of budgets. So that straight away scared me. And another thing he did in this very short first meeting that I had after Irma, he called his secretary and said, you know, there was this some particular pamphlet had come about a particular technology. And he asked that lady to find that out and get me a Xerox copy. And that was a wind-powered ice plant. So, you know, ice being very important for fisheries. So he told me way back in 83, he gave me the pamphlet for a wind-powered ice plant, which I suspect doesn't exist even today in India. But, you know, that is how forward-thinking he was in technology and things like that. So, yes, that left a deep mark on me, though I at many stages in time, I was never too sure whether the think big, standardize to the extent possible. These are policies that can be a prescription for every situation. So I've always been debating on my mind. But yes, this is what Dr. Kurian said, and this was the basis of his success.
Thanks a lot, Vivek, for your reflections. We've had a very rich set of ideas and inspirations from Dr. Kurian and his work. And we will move now to the second round of discussions, which we will start in a reverse order. And Balu Iyer will be moderating this. But before I hand it over to Balu, I would just like to request all the participants to feel free to use the question and answer sessions, the part of the webinar, to post your questions. Some have Nitin and someone else has already shared this. The panelists might be feel free to also answer if they want to do now or a bit later, or we can take it up with the questions a bit later. But let this be a continuing process. So I encourage all of you to share your ideas or chat in the chat or in the question answers if you have a specific question. Over to you, Balu.
Thank you very much, Professor
Sharma. Just one more, before you get started. We also welcome Sri Nagendranath Sinha, the Secretary of Rural Development. Nagendranath ji, whenever you feel like saying something, please feel free to let us know, and you could also join this conversation. Over to you, Balu.
Again, thank you very much, Professor Shambhu. And while going through the list of registered participants, I saw the United Artists Association, and this was an organization, I think 30 years back, I had the interaction while working with Action Aid, and they were also a fisherman's group working to form cooperatives. So it's very encouraging to see the list of participants who have registered and shown the interest. Let me thank all the panelists. I think it's been very inspiring to hear your experiences with Dr. Kurian, directly or indirectly, and what you've been able to take back and how you put it into practice. I think that's important in terms of how we practice it in our work, in our day-to-day lives. He comes across, again, as a larger-than-life person who could be intimidating at one level, but at the same time, when interacting with farmers and working with directly, could be much, much personal. So he ranges the spectrum. And his influence is not just in the country. As part of the International Cooperative Alliance, the ICA awards the Rochdale Pioneer Awards to cooperators who have contributed immensely to the cooperative movement. And Dr. Kurian was awarded the first Rochdale Pioneer Award. And in my travels across country, the ICA is a member-based countries, and we have close to 111 members from 31 countries. And when I travel across all these countries, the one name which consistently appears, it doesn't matter whether it's in Fiji or it's in Palestine or any country in between, it's Dr. Kurian's name which comes up. And so it shows that what he's done is not just limited to India, but across the border. again, all our panelists have talked about their experiences and what they've learned from Kurien and how they have adopted the principles and how they are practicing it. So what I would like to touch upon in this round is, how relevant are cooperatives and collectives today? And what are the new forms of engagement or action that you all are seeing? So maybe I will again start with Vivekanandan. You've been on the first batch and you've seen cooperatives from the beginning. How do you see it today, and what do you see as its relevance, and how do you see it moving forward?
Thank you, Balu.
Yeah,
I think this is a very important question. Ever since 1991, when India liberalized its economy, by which what is actually very narrowly meant is that the corporate sector was largely released from the fetters it had. The cooperatives and the very other sectors did not have an equal, opening or awakening. It was a limited kind of liberalization. And as a result, the total orientation of policy and the way people look at things, the aspirations of youngsters, have all changed in a particular manner. However, all of us who work with the various rural producers and other sections of poor who have their own livelihoods, we are talking of livelihoods. So cooperatives being a business organization, as was strongly emphasized by Sita, it is very important to know that it's a livelihood base, it's not a charity. So it's a business organization. So the relevance of cooperatives in today's world is as strong as it was earlier. In some ways, even stronger. For the very simple reason that we have large numbers of small people doing small businesses, which are in competition with large businesses. The economies of scale that is required to improve these livelihoods require collective action quite often. It's not just a question of creating a level playing field or creating various policies to encourage the small. It's not enough. There are many, many sectors and many, many spheres of life where collective enterprises are very crucial. Be they be for aggregating produce or bulk purchase of inputs, getting professional services, and so on. So the need for cooperatives is still very strong. I will, since I have worked almost entirely with the fisheries sector, and that too small scale fishermen and fisherwomen, let me share some of the new dimensions that are emerging in addition to the old requirement of collective bargaining and aggregation of the produce for the market. The model with which I ended up as part of this SIPS work was largely a three-tier organization with village organizations which control the first point of sale. And then higher level entities at district level, and then a overall apex, which would take care of many districts and cut across state boundaries. Of course, the nature of the fisheries sector created very peculiar problems in terms of design. So there are many design issues in cooperatives which are still very important and which still need to be looked at. Arnold Patton is an important reference point. It's an important point to check what you are doing. But on the other hand, in its totality, it is not applicable in all sectors and in all commodities. So one has to develop, we found that the idea that from the producer to the consumer, the entire chain can be under cooperative control, very difficult idea to implement in the sector for the very simple reason that the scale is just not there. Milk is a single commodity, even if you make multiple products. fish is actually, each species has its own demand supply differences, where it is produced, where it is consumed, and what type of technology is needed to handle it. So there are a whole set of issues that finally we realized that fish is a basket of commodities. So it is not a single commodity cooperative. And if you depend on one species or two species for which you decode all the value chain requirements, you will not have the scale because it's highly seasonal. So 3 months a particular species is available and you develop products and markets related to that. The remaining 9 months, you will not be able to do much with that. So it requires a very different approach. And the seasonality aspect is so important in this scale dimension because the to be able to, if you are supplying fish to a particular center like say Chennai, consumers in a center of Chennai or Bombay, any of the coastal cities which have a huge demand for marine fish. There is no location in India, however wide you make it geographically, which can take care of this round the year supplies. You really need to have coast-to-coast organizations which can supply. Today, in fact, we have a 2-month ban in fishing on the west coast of India for environmental and resource protection requirements. And very little fish, only small boats are allowed, below 10 horsepower. So only a small percentage of the requirements of the west coast is now consumers is being met from production from west coast. Today, fish is coming for Bombay and even up to Kerala, from Bengal to Kanyakumari, east coast catches. So there is a coast-to-coast frame. So this is the commodity where we realize that the first point of sale intervention gives us the best result, more than attempts to do anything more than that. And we found that the biggest benefits come through aggregation or people getting together at higher levels, village co-ops forming district federations, is coming from inputs, control over inputs. So supply of boats, supply of motors, supply of fuel, supply of ice, many of these things is where actually the business lies, opportunity lies. And I was subsequently, I learned also, this is a fact in many parts of the world, that fisheries cooperatives make more money by supplying their members' inputs than by selling the produce that their members is, are catching for the market. So the sector design, all these things are very unique to each commodity and each this. Another issue that we have encoded is this whole social dimension. Dairying is essentially an agrarian part of the agrarian economy. And socially, in the agrarian society in India is multicaste and hierarchical. And the dairy sector has adapted to that. And the dairy cooperatives are therefore open to all social groups who are in the agrarian sector accessing it. Despite internal differences, the ability to manage the reduce the inequity in the system and to ensure that it is a smooth operation despite all the internal differences, class caste differences in the rural society, is a great achievement of the dairy cooperatives. But the fishery sector is very different. We almost all our cooperatives are working in a what we call a single caste environment. There is a largely an egalitarian social system with one caste, being all of them are fishermen, both owners, workers, no difference in customs. And it is a hereditary occupation, and therefore the social group with which we work is also considerably defined, and it overlaps heavily with our cooperative system. So the social, so we have a strong community dimension in our work, because nothing can be delinked from the community to which they belong. The other area which we have had to work on has been the whole issue of CPRs, common property resources. How the cooperatives can work in a common property regime, though quite often we are also working in the market in terms of sales and inputs, both are we access the open market to sell our fish or to buy our requirements for the fishermen. The dairying is
Austin. Looks like we might have lost Vivekanandan.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes,
we can hear you now.
Okay, so the CPR plays a bigger role because the fish resource belongs to no one. It is mobile. It moves from coast to coast. The oil sardine is caught right from Ratnagiri on the west coast and goes down the coast and goes up the coast towards up to Puri in Orissa. So the resource boundaries are very large and long distance travel. And it's a common resource and a finite resource which overexploited lead to depletion and destruction of the resource. So there is a limit to extraction, and cooperatives can unwittingly actually lead to overexploitation of the resource. The government took up our model in Kerala and created a large cooperative organization called the Matsya Fed. But its financing of fishermen with subsidies and the technologies, in fact, they were even subsidizing technologies that the fisheries department had banned. So there are so many other environmental and other issues also which we deal with. And therefore, it becomes a lot more complicated in terms of design and scale of operations. So there is a whole set of these things that we have worked on, and we have reached certain levels of understanding of all this. But we have a great problem, that is where Dr. Kurien and the NDDP and the whole system. Management of the external environment is something that is very difficult and impossible for the kind of organization that we are often working with. They don't have either the scale or importance. Something that I need to also mention as part of the CPR problem is that today the bulk of the catch is not with our small fishermen. It is with large boats which are competing with them, who are operating from fishing harbors, selected harbors. Each state has half a dozen of them. And from there, large boats go out and catch. And they operate more or less in the same area that our fishermen, small fishermen operate, target the same species, and take a bulk of them. So this sharp division in the production system makes it also very difficult to attain any scale, because our cooperatives can see no reason, can see no common ground in marketing with the larger fellows. We are in direct competition for the catch itself. So any incentives given through improved markets can only be for the small fishermen. It cannot be for the larger fellows. So this kind of very serious kind of issues are there in design and organization and limitations of some of these things. But we have found our own ways of doing these things, and there's still a long way ahead. And at the moment, some of the challenges that we are facing is the typical commodity cooperative model is not suitable in fisheries for resource management. And therefore, we are working on new sets of organizations, which is also a collective organization, but very different from a cooperative in that it is not a business organization. It is only to mediate between the various subsectors in the fisheries and to create what we consider a co-management, a resource co-management system. So this is the new area of collectivization that we are looking at, and we are working on models. We are also finding that if fishermen are the start of this value chain, represent the start of the value chain, fisherwomen, at least on the coast, represent the end of the chain who deal with the consumers. And therefore, we are trying to see how to organize them and ensure that their livelihood is also very important and they can also get a good deal. And it is quite difficult sometimes because there are conflicts of interest. If you look at it from a producer perspective, you find one kind of a policy emerging. But if you look at it from the retailer point of view, you can look at it very differently. So for instance, one can look at all our fishermen cooperatives going online and selling all their fish, dispensing with the need for women even to sell the fish. Then what happens to the women's livelihood? So there are many such conflicting areas and interests that we have to now straddle to find how to maintain a balance, gender balance even within the fishery, and to find some kind of solutions. So environmental and common property resource issues, gender issues, these are all the new dimensions that we are facing as we are now moving in cooperativizing and collectivizing. And something that I should also mention before I end is that even though I've been loosely using the term cooperatives, Balu's own ICA may not recognize the organizations I have worked with as a cooperative. Hardly, I think, except for the very first cooperative, the Marinad one, none of them have a cooperative registration. For the very simple reason that the fisheries cooperatives across India have been set up as a state monopoly with no business whatsoever, and only as a conduit for subsidies and schemes of the government, state governments, and the central government occasionally. So this is just registered as a cooperative, having all the legal seal of a cooperative, and we cannot, and many, and our cooperatives could never get the registration of cooperative because area of operations limitations, etc., made it clear that there's no way. And eventually we would reconcile this and even be happy because the cooperatives have failed. Fisheries cooperatives have failed most of India only because of the government patronage, which has completely distorted the sector. One of my batchmates, Suresh Balakrishnan, used to say, getting in bed with the government, it's a very dangerous thing for cooperatives. It is the Dhritarashtra's embrace. He calls it a Dhritarashtra's embrace. So Kerala, our growth was badly curtailed. It still exists because once you have formed, the cooperatives seem to be somewhat very difficult to even kill sometimes. Everything is adverse. But once the people have taken an ownership and say, this is our cooperative, despite great adversity, despite competition from the state system, a set of people in southern districts of Kerala still served by the SISWIS network grumble all the time, but would never quit. Because it's their independent, their own organization. Even when we said, let's close down, they never closed down. So the whole problem is this policy thing of the cooperatives, and that is where we'll be talking hopefully in the next round a little bit about the new Ministry of Cooperatives, and is it an enhancement of Dhritarashtra's embrace, or it is Dhritarashtra becoming somebody else? So we do not know. So this has been another challenge that I have been working with. None of the cooperatives I have been part of organizing as the CHOP of the cooperative system. We are not part of any official cooperative movements. So that is also a major problem in some sectors where state patronage, especially of weaker sectors, tribals, fishers, has taken the form of cooperativization for using a business entity, but not doing any business. I'm going to stop with this. There's a lot more I can talk about.
I'm sure. Thank you very much, Vivekanandan. You've touched upon a lot of important issues. But I'll move to Damu. Hi, Damu. Nice to see you here. I'll take from what the last point which Vivekanandan mentioned about gender. And when I look at what's happened in this post-COVID world, a lot of the sectors and people who've been affected are in the services and the social sector. And Pradhan in particular has been doing a lot of work in terms of addressing the needs. So how do you see in terms of the relevance of cooperatives in the post-pandemic world? And what is it that y'all are looking at, Pradhan is looking at? How are y'all looking at this issue?
Yeah, thanks. Thank you, Balu. Again, wonderful to see you here. I'm audible, no?
Yes, you are.
So it's always a pleasure to listen to Vivek. I mean, I've had the fortune of visiting SIFS. And I was actually, when he spoke about cooperatives, I was thinking that he said, no, all our organizations are registered as societies. But the idea was, you know, they are registered as people's organization in spite of the society registration 1860, etc. He's kind of played with it and made it actually a shadow cooperative in a way, because as he said, the cooperatives are not working. So, and interestingly, Vivek, maybe you do not know, but many of us call that you are the Kurian of fisheries. In a sense, you know, building on people's initiatives and what's, you know, in the sense, smallholders and artisanal fishers, people of very limited means and technologies, doing that and then aggregating that through collective and handing it over to them in a sense. So the same way, even though, as you just said, how the fishery sector is so different from the milk sector, even though both are highly perishable commodities, but exists very differently, but you have kind of created and built on people's strength. And that is what I think the that is an eternal kind of philosophy that Pradhan also works on, Balu, that we need to build that people's build on the people, in a sense, people. That's what I was saying in the earlier intervention about the people's space, and we can maybe expand it to the citizen space, that how do we actually build on their own resources and their own endowments, and then and actually draw on what Shambhu said in his podcast in the morning today. Some of you may have heard it, where he spoke about the solidarity economy. It sounds very interesting when you go solidarity and the economy. So basically, that is about how the whole economic the edifice gets built on the initiatives of people and dispersed, diverse, small interventions by common people, and aggregate them into through collectives, cooperatives, or now more and more through producer companies, or any other form, doesn't matter, different kinds of forms, but individually small, but very vibrant, bringing it together and building on them. And so that has also been the vision of Pradhan, that how do we build on the people and their resources and skills, and then obviously we all support to enhance it. So what we see in a village, we look at multiple institutions, not just the economic institution. We also, as I said in the beginning, we also work through self-help groups quite a lot. So self-help groups, federations, and the village organizations, federation, the whole edifice of, let's say, the social institutions, even though they also quite into finance and banking, but the social, we call the social mobilization institutions, which actually brings the women together, small groups and many groups in a village. So they're not necessarily economic collectives, but they're actually more very much about their space and building on their leadership skills and the management skills. So many things get built, and that is a preparatory ground for these SAG members to graduate to different kinds of institutions. We have a large plethora of economic institutions, cooperatives around agriculture, horticulture, sericulture, smallholder poultry, livestock. So there could be as forest produce. So as many as economic activities they have, we have as many collectives. So you're looking at a multiplicity of collectives. And we also say, so these two exist together. And we say that the local panchayat, which is also another form of a people's institution, more in the political and governance space, that also needs to be as vibrant. And all of them have a main same character, that they are all built on people's aspirations and people's, exists in the people's space and built on their resources, skills. And this is, I think, the so I will expand the term solidarity economy into, let us say, the solidarity ecosystem, where there is a much larger solidarity of all people in the village coming together, which actually, in Pradhan's perspective, that is what is the, let's say, the ground for doing the work that we want to do in order with rural development, promoting livelihoods. And I would further enhance it, or let's say extend it, by saying a feminine solidarity ecosystem, because in all these groups, we are all highly women centric, the self-help groups or the producer organizations that we have. And in the panchayats also, we look forward to having as many women as possible. So this collective, which is far more and feminine in a more philosophical sense, which is more nurturing, which is more inclusive and much more sensitive to the economy and to each other and to the ecology as well. So it kind of brings in multiple aspects together in this solidarity collective that we see in the village. And that is what I think our definition of development. If we can create vibrant people systems, and then rest of the whole edifice, administrative edifice, the bureaucracy, the politicians, everything exists to enhance this, that, build on the people and then respond to their requires. So as Kurian would have wanted, you need to keep them out of both the government and the bureaucracy. And you can actually see, when I look back at the history of each of these institutions, the self-help groups are more recent, but the panchayats or the cooperatives, you necessarily see that this, since they are people's organizations and since they build on people's aspirations and quote-unquote people politics, nobody wants this to really become strong. Therefore, you would see too much of interference both in the panchayat system and both in the cooperative system. And I don't know how much the self-help group will continue, but my hypothesis is right, at some point in the self-help group movement also will get highly co-opted into the state system. Mr. Anand Sinha is sitting here. He's one of the rare exceptions who really understands the, you know, the people dynamics. But generally, the bureaucracy nor the politicians, they actually appreciate people's aspirations or people politics to come up. Because, you know, then it's responding to that is very difficult. So rather, you know, you superimpose your ideas and your thing. But so this is my vision, and this is what Pradhan is working together, that how do we create that solidarity ecosystem at the ground and then build other the support by the civil society, support from the bureaucracies. How do we bring the rest of the larger economic and political systems to really support what the people are, people's aspirations are. So, you know, kind of modeling development in a very democratic, and this is also the next part, which I don't know whether Dr. Kurian would have, I think he implicitly believed in that, you know, these institutions that we create at the ground are also contributing to building the grassroots democracy. It is actually building the foundation of, you know, people's participation in the governance in the country. So therefore, the more the need to allow them that space, so in the economic sense, allow them that policy space and allow them the economic space to build world-class, economic activities. And we have, as we see, the Anand model cooperatives or the work that SIFS does or a lot of work that Pradhan has done. We see very high quality products coming out of these, the enterprises that people have, whether it is the farms or from their poultry units or from any the crafts, etc. Highly world-class products coming out and in competing in the open market as with other private sector products. So in a sense, it is possible. There is potential there. There is possibility there. But provided we kind of perceive it like that and we kind of philosophically agree with this idea that, you know, we need to build on the people taking forward development in the way that we want and also strengthening our democracy and democratic institutions. And unless the people are empowered in this manner, it becomes very difficult in a sense, you know. And there was a question about how do the people's collective interface with the market? They interface very efficiently. One-to-one, it becomes difficult for the, you know, the whole idea of cooperatives, right? The economic collective. But they're able to, if facilitated and if, and that I think what is required. And that is one, some of the problems that we face. Now that is if facilitated and if appropriate capacities are built, they are able to produce high quality produce. In a sense, whether it is a poultry bird or, you know, the silk fabric or whatever, they are able to produce the high quality. But the issue is today what we face is, even though we work with the, promoting these institutions, the support to facilitate, to build skills and build the various, you know, the good high quality management and professional systems in these institutions, I think, those kinds of investments need to be much more. Today we are part of the Ministry of Agriculture's 10,000 FPO program. They give a very piddly little 5 lakh rupees, per CBO per year, which is actually so little that we are not able to deploy the best quality people to do it. What we are saying, the best, as Dr. Kurian says, or as Vijaya says, we need the best quality people to go and work with these institutions, because the idea is about building India. It's not just the idea of building one cooperative there. So we need people with that vision and people with those capabilities and that empathy to work at the community. We need to place high quality people. The human resource component is very important. That requires resources. So the facilitating institution, whether it is NABARD or the Government of India or the philanthropy, we need to resource that very well. That, you know, how do you build these institutions and build high quality institutions? And it is possible. It has been demonstrated thousands of times across cooperatives and institutions in India. Policies are very important, but irrespective of policies and policy impediments, if you build people's capabilities, they're able to kind of, the whole six cooperatives are built on societies and charitable societies. The Gujarat cooperatives are the earlier traditional cooperatives. Today, we have the Mutually Aided Cooperative Act in Andhra Pradesh and Jharkhand and many places. We have the producer company option. So there are different options that are available. Any options, but unless you build the capacities of the people. And second important lesson we have had is building the enterprise is very important. Again, it is not just enough to start, you know, getting all 300, 400 or 500 farmers into a cooperative. We need to ensure the business viability. And once the business is viable individually at the household level and collectively at the group level, then the the form doesn't particularly matter, the legal form. But you know what? Because if the business makes sense, the members will be interested in working on that business. And if the business doesn't make sense or is making very little money at the individual level, then again the household might lose interest, as you say, the centrality of the activity. So therefore, there are these areas we need to work on: the centrality of the business itself, the viability of the business, and then the quality of these institutions, its internal management and governance system. It is all possible to do it, provided we have the more facilitating environment, we're able to place good quality people. So these remain the challenges. You know, how do we find resources for this?
Thanks, Damu. I think you've touched upon these important things, that it's not just the legal form, but then cooperatives are enterprises which work on values and principles. So how much do we give emphasis to that, I think, becomes very important. Thanks a lot. Let me move to Sweta. You are the youngest, in terms of having passed out the most recent. And one of the challenges we face, or the cooperative movement faces, or I think collectives face also, is how do we attract the younger generation? When we look at what the younger generation aspires and what they feel about the world they live in, they look at inequality, they look at the climate change, they look at the work environment, and they seem to be dissatisfied, and they want to work in a place which has values, which has principles, which is where they see a purpose. Cooperatives and collectives work on those principles and offer that, but then there seems to be some kind of disconnect. So how would you see in terms of putting this message across about cooperatives to the younger generation?
So to be honest, I'm more of an action-oriented person than reflecting a lot. So when I was invited for this speech, I'm just all over the place as how do I really gather the work of 17 years. So, but actually not thinking a lot helped me, because all of these questions I never thought, because I'm 40 and I'm the oldest person in my organization. So I have a team which is less than 30. So all the three producer companies, all the 20 staff, their average age is less than 30. So actually it's never occurred to me. Maybe we did something right for them to make it very interesting. And in terms of, say, the skills that we worked on, or the salaries at the local level that have been provided. Because one thing has been a guiding force for me in this. One weaver once commented that he and his schoolmate, they both studied together. So he became a teacher and earns 25,000 a month. And he became a weaver and earns 10,000. So always at the organization level, for us, we want to, in the correct sense, positive sense, make professionals out of weavers. So we have been always working with providing that kind of an environment, that kind of decent pay at the local level, and see the salaries of the staff of Chitrika and the producer company. We always have these metrics, like what is the gap? How can we fill? Because the weaver is a professional, he's a skilled professional. But so definitely, low on managerial skills, because they didn't have an access. Because I have a privileged background, I had the access to have a managerial education they didn't have. I took 5 years to learn, they will take 10 years to learn. So that's the thing. So attracting young people is an issue, but I think with the right kind of organization environment and addressing their aspirations, I think it is not a great challenge, I think, at the organization or the producer company level. And definitely this, I think this question would come in the third round, maybe third round others can speak, but where I want to add, young people will come if there is a lot of agility in the organization. So for example, a designer from NID and a designer from the community both work together in Chitrika. I think that kind of a level playing ground where the language is an issue, the creativity is not an issue, I think that's very important, so that to attract right kind of crowd, and a lot of agility is required in the organization so that a young crowd comes. So that's the thing. So some part is already covered in terms of the nature of the cooperative, so I don't want to take a lot of time on it, but I surely want to start with, there are like 21,765 primary weaver cooperatives are registered in Andhra and Telangana, but I don't think they're cooperative in intent and following cooperative principles. More or less, they're government organizations. So I think in crafts and in weaving, the cooperative movement, is a non-starter. It has not been there. Okay, more or less, these cooperatives have been government organizations, and even though they have been performing, we have case studies of well-performing cooperatives and all that, there is government equity, government asset in all the cooperatives. So for us in Chitrika, the relevance of cooperative and the journey of cooperative has been made easy because of a good ecosystem of cooperatives. Mutually aided cooperative society act was introduced, where we are also very much influenced by CDS work and Sashi's philosophy, Sashi Rajagopalan's philosophy. So for us, getting the producer, getting the weavers registered and mutually aided cooperative society, even though it was difficult, we already had an ecosystem. We didn't have to really fight with the registrar, because during the first registration of the first cooperative, the registrar, we were not able to register the cooperative under the new act. But the registrar, then we approached the registrar of cooperatives. He said, why are we really bothered about these new societies and all? They don't have a new act. They don't have assets of the government. So let them go to DOCS, he said. So I think we didn't go to DOCS, but eventually the cooperative, mutual aided cooperative was registered. Now they are in the producer company form, because during 2013-14, there were rumors that something is going to happen to the Max Act and some amendments were to be introduced. So at that time, we converted the existing mutually aided cooperative society into a producer company. And eventually now we are getting registered in the producer company. And so far going is good, because as I said, I never really thought much about the government, government equity, government funding, government interference. And so far we concentrated on following the intent of the cooperative and following the cooperative principles. And as discussed in detail, for us, the business fundamentals were very important. So for us, the net profit has always have been a key driving force. So we looked at the net profit, gross profit, all other indicators. Net profit, what is the bonus that goes to the community? So today, in one of the oldest producer companies, a weaver earns 2.5 times the national average, and they get a bonus of minimum of 10,000 at the end of the year. So a lot of these things have been developed, and we stuck to the core fundamentals of how a cooperative should be. That's one. And relevance of cooperative, I think I first was very confused what to say and all. I mean, it's very obvious. I didn't understand that question actually, because I feel my work started. So Vijay Spitha from Hyderabad, brought up in Hyderabad, can start a shop in Banjara Hills and borrowing some 20 crores. And trading. Somebody asked, why didn't we start with the trading? Just trade, procure and build a nice market pipeline, and then we can build cooperatives and systems and work on the value chain and the community and all. That was a very temptation I had in 2005 when I worked. Start a shop in Banjara Hills. Swita madam hai, achha wages bhi mil jayega, weavers ka income. So that's one easy way to tempt when to make a scale, to go to the scale and get to that kind of money. We didn't take that route. So collectively, I mean, before COVID, this 586 weaver households were touching a turnover of 5 crores and earning a decent income. So we took a route of working on the entire value chain. So worked on the production, the marketing, and building traceability in the system. And to address one of the questions of standardization, we introduced a lot of standardization. Once one of the, again, I think Irman from the past batches asked, अरे डेरी में तो फैट एंड एस एन एफ है, वीविंग में क्या चेक करेंगे आप? हाउ आई मीन इट्स वेरी डिजी दैट हाउ डू वी वर्क ऑन द स्टैंडर्डाइजेशन ऑफ क्वालिटी. आई मीन टुडे वी हैव अ फॉर्मूला फॉर एक्चुअली डिटरमाइनिंग द वेजेस. सो ओवर द लॉट ऑफ ईयर ऑफ वर्क, डेफिनेटली स्टैंडर्डाइजेशन इज पॉसिबल. सो वी बिल्ट इन ऑल ऑफ द सिस्टम अक्रॉस द वैल्यू चेन, सो दैट इट एड्रेसेस द बेसिक क्वेश्चन. लाइक इट कैन बी एनी बिजनेस फॉर्म, राइट? कॉर्पोरेट कर सकते हैं, प्राइवेट कर सकते हैं, सोसाइटी कर सकते हैं. बट वॉट इज कोर एंड रिलेवेंट फॉर एन ऑर्गेनाइजेशन टू बी अ कॉपरेटिव इज डेफिनेटली इन आंध्र वी हैव अ गुड लीगल इको सिस्टम विच इज देयर एंड विच इज इम्पॉर्टेंट विच गिव्स अ लीगल फ्रेमवर्क फॉर वॉट वी कॉल एज डिस्ट्रीब्यूटिव जस्टिस. सो एज आई सेड, अगर विजय स्मिता सोल प्रोपरेटरशिप बंजारा हिल शॉप में है, देर इज नो लीगल फ्रेमवर्क फॉर डिस्ट्रीब्यूटिव जस्टिस. विजय स्मिता माइट वॉन्ट टू गिव, हर सन माइट नॉट वॉन्ट टू गिव. So I think it's very important to build this intergenerational organization with distributive justice and cooperative intent and principles. Cooperatives are very much relevant. And in the last 12 years, we've been able to actually build with government support, I would say, is a form of complete non-interference. So I think it's very important. So without any of the interference from the government, we are able to build. So I think distributive justice is a key word. And another 2-3 important points. Design of the cooperative is very important. People say cooperatives fail hote hain. Corporates mein bhi utne hi failures. Jitne cooperatives mein hai utne hi corporate. As the they say there's this theory of redundancy is in the nature. Like we have good professionals, bad professionals. The percentage is always going to be in single digit, single percentages. So in the same way, the failure, if you look at in corporates and cooperatives, will not be actually much different. But I think as an organization, we worked on key thing. Following, as I said, cooperative principles, intent, and in following business fundamentals. And very importantly, borrowing from CDF and Sashi Rajagopalan's learning, internal capital accumulation of the members, where the members save. So today in the producer company in Srikakulam, 50% of the working capital is financed by the savings of the weavers in the last 10 years. Their member-owned funds is 1 crore, where their external borrowings is hardly 1 crore. It's 50-50. So it's very important the members stick to the cooperative, they build their trust. So these three fundamentals are we have never compromised and continue to run. And lastly, specific to the weaving sector, what has happened is people call it sunset. So nobody wants to invest in the technology, and technology is a bad word. If you are a handloom purist, the weaver has to, the dyeing has to happen manually. A lot of things has to happen manually. There's a lot of elitist romanticism as far as weaving is concerned. So when you talk about the standardization of dyeing through mechanization, it's a blasphemy. So all of these are there. So a lot of investment in technology for repeated activities where creativity is not involved has been completely neglected. Neither the academic institutions nor the research organizations or NGOs didn't have that kind of skills to invest in the appropriate intermediary technology, whether in spinning, whether in dyeing technology or other spaces. I think collectives run properly or poised at a level where the appropriate technology interventions, whether in spinning or the post weaving activities can happen. I think in that way, collectives are very relevant because only they, new generation collectives, can invest in this technology. Where in the value chain, where you can increase the cotton farmers, because cotton farmers grow local cotton or the XYZ. But after that, we need end clothing, right? That is not addressed. The entire spinning technology for short staple cotton is still zero. Still, it is Gandhi Charkha. So I think it's very much important. Well-performing collectives can, at a scale, invest in appropriate intermediate technology. We're already in our producer companies. We have a 40 lakh investment in a complete traceability technology, which the 50% investment has come from the producers. So it is doable. They are modern agile entities. And and as all of you know, the best products producer to consumer model has been from the cooperatives, whether Timbuktu, whether Amul, the best quality products were fair valued, reasonably priced products have come from the cooperatives. I think it's an important lesson even for the corporates. So if you want to anytime really work closely and connect the producer to the consumer and at fair value, the value chain which works for the producer, consumer, and the vendors in between, I think collectives is the only go. And as far as handloom is concerned, we always, when we started work, we wanted master weavers to die very soon because they are the one who have control over the weavers, and there are cooperatives anyways which are not working. So I was waiting in Ponduru, when will the master weaver die, when he will be 70, 80? But now he has reached 70 and he is unwell, I heard. But all across Andhra and Telangana, the master weavers is a disappearing breed. And definitely others, the younger generation will come, but 50% is definitely going to die. So new forms are needed. And for mainstreaming handlooms, I think collectives are extremely important to take it to an appropriate scale. Okay. So I understand 586 is a small scale and we always are being asked scale, scale, scale. So for me, appropriate scale is very important. And for me, the important metrics, when we can sleep and well at night and working on collective, is business has to make money. The producer has to make a lot of money from the wages, from the assets that have been created by them, and from the bonus. And that distributive justice is possible only because of collective. And lastly, to sum up, I would also say, I used to take this proposal, different funding organization was new, we will do this for the weavers, all of these, they used to have, give us a solution. So at 25, what solution can I give? I don't know the sector much, what solution? But I always used to say, we will create professionals out of weavers. Weavers will do this, do that, all that kind of a thing. Is it? Weavers production and production karne do na, ye professional manage karenge. I understand still a lot of professional support goes to the producer enterprises from Chitrika and where the staff are from best of the institutions. But so far we have paved a way where we are creating a mini MBA for the staff of the producer companies, where they get skilled and the services for their own skill will go back to the producer enterprises. Because in the craft sector, there are many interventions where a lot of skilling, a lot of innovation is happening in teaching management. But this is again my personal view. We teach management to individual entrepreneurs. Maybe we'll end up creating more Frankensteins or a very enlightened master weaver, and then what later, we don't know. So for me, it's very important that skill, the managerial skill, that mini MBA of the craft persons and weavers go back to larger crowds. So that's possible only when there is collective and there is an active demand from the community. So collectives are very much relevant, and at least from 17 years of experience, we have done wonderfully. But intent and the cooperative principles are important.
Thank you, Smita. I think for me, the point you mentioned about intergenerational, I think when I talked about young, we need to bring that between the old and the young. How do we build that connection and continue that? And the fact that you've also introduced this management of, and these I think are skills for the younger people and you're talking about. So we need to, one, build this intergenerational connection, build professionalism. And the one other point which you mentioned, how do we make this aware of all this good thing which is happening? Young people are not aware. They only hear about all the negative news. So how do we promote all the good things that are happening? I think that's the way to go. Let me move. Thank you very much. And let me move to Emmanuel Murray. I think I've been told we are running out of time. But Emmanuel, there have been a couple of points which I wanted you to touch upon. One is there's been talk about technology and how relevant it is, and also financing. So from your perspective, how do you see both these things when we are talking about newer forms and newer generations of cooperatives?
Yeah, I think technology is out there available, but do the cooperatives have both the capital and the managerial skills manage these technologies is a challenge. So therefore, I think there are limitations in being able to access technology. On the financial side, since I'm more from that side, there are serious questions about both governance and capability of these institutions to manage external financial resources. And therefore, I think if you call the CEO of a bank, he will talk grandly about funding FPOs and he'll say, I'll instruct my team to do it. But when you go back, it's actually the cutting edge branch manager who has to process a loan proposal. And there he sees that there are issues of proper record keeping being absent, power being centralized with a few, lack of separation between the board and the management, the staff being of poor capacity, the market linkages not being as good. So we have a few, as all those present here are showing up, good examples. But if we're looking to go to scale, unfortunately, the resources are there, but the capability of these institutions on a wider scale to access those resources has been limiting. And I think, therefore, we, even at the policy level or at the apex level, have hesitation and kind of pushing to say that pump in more financial resources into these institutions. So it has to be selectively done, and we have to build those institutions bottom up, and then only they'll be able to access those resources. So financial resources are really not a constraint, but their readiness to manage these resources prudently seems to be a serious question. So there are a few after whom all lenders run. There'll be three guys willing to lend to one place, and there'll be no one willing to lend to maybe 90 out of 100 of those institutions, and that challenge continues to remain countrywide.
Yeah, so Balu, if I may just jump in a bit, because we are running short of time. So I'm going to try and force a little bit of pace on this round three for the panelists. So we would like you to address three broad questions. You may address only two or one of them, and we would like you to do it in a couple of minutes. So the first is, what's been the impact of collectives on due to COVID, very briefly? Some might have faced it more than others. Why do you think cooperatives continue to be relevant and related in this context? Some of you probably have addressed this, but there's been a request from at least a few of the questions on what might be your one or two recommendations for the Ministry of Cooperatives, or how do you see the idea and the collective enterprises as we go ahead? So I just request, we'll start again with Emmanuel and end with Vivek, but let's try and be brief so that we can take a couple of questions as well. Just before you start, Emmanuel, I would just like to know whether Nagendranath Sinhaji wants to share something. And Professor Pepin, you had your hand raised. You want to say something briefly now?
Well, okay. I can come after this round is over.
Sure. Yes, Emmanuel, go ahead.
Okay, so I think the informal sector has been badly hit by the COVID. But wherever there have been collectives, their ability, particularly agricultural cooperatives, to bounce back and get market linkages back on track has been quick and quite effective also, although prices have taken a dip because of demand constraints. So collectives, or those who have been members of collectives, have benefited being part of those collectives. Cooperatives, the relevance of cooperatives today, I think there's no question on that. We recently did one study for the government of AP on revamping credit cooperatives, and we've seen many successful cooperative societies doing business larger than a branch bank in the same locality. So I think there are enough evidence to show that cooperatives can work even in a competitive market environment. On the recommendations to the government, I really fail to kind of comprehend, and I would just like to quote Dr. Kurian. You know, at this point of time, he said, the registrar of cooperative societies should become like the registrar of companies. So he has to register, receive the accounts, and maybe wind up a company if it is not performing. So it should not interfere much more than that. So probably that issue still really remains relevant today. Some of you are talking about the FPOs movement. It has been so centralized today that it's being run from Delhi. And I think if FPO was such a great idea, what were you doing all these years? You know, it's been 20 years in the making. And please, you know, keep the cooperative character in cooperatives is the only request to the government, and don't turn it into something else. So cooperation is what they ask, but please keep cooperatives as they are. Thank you.
Thanks, Emmanuel. Vijayashwita, I think you had responded immediately after COVID for relief for the weavers, but also had to deal with a slightly different situation. Very briefly, what's the impact of COVID and any other part you might want to speak?
Yeah, impact of COVID, canceled orders, 50% production only. So it means 50% income loss to the weavers, 3 crore stock. So that's what currently we are able to sleep with at night. And so that has been the impact. But overall, since they are collectives and we usually follow strong principle of no grants into the producer companies or very less subsidies. But this year we had to let go because we also try to mobilize grants for supporting some of the overheads of the producer company, though in a limited way. But non-cash support like grocery and all has gone through Chitrika to the weaver producers. So it continues to do so. So currently the situation in the last 1.5 years continues to be the same with 50% of sales. So I quickly to jump on how are we dealing. As I said, we have built a lot of agility in the system. So 2019-20, the e-commerce sales was 4 lakhs. 2021, in the 3-4 months, we got it up to 40 lakhs. So built in a lot of agility so that online store can work well. So that's one way which we have worked on to help the community. And secondly, since they are collectives, as I said, they're able to withstand a bit. There are many organizations or smaller collectives that have been shut down where as an organization, though we are working in the same region, we're not able to help out much. Because whatever little we had to distribute it to the weavers with whom we are working. So, but I want to dwell on the second question of way forward. As I said, agility in the system, and we are heavily focusing on building the producer to consumer model in the weaving, where we are experimenting with a model where the consumers can upfront pay for some of the working capital. That's a model and app-based sales where community, the producers upfront pay for the products, pre-order the products, support in the working capital, and we provide a wallet-based kind of a system where they can keep on buying for an year. They want to put 4,000, 5,000, 1,000 or whatever. This is the model currently we are experimenting. Nascent stage, I don't know how it will work or not work out. So I think in this financial year, we'll get to know about it. And second thing is what is emerging is also a lot of access. Market is in some ways more democratized that a weaver can go up and in the social media or WhatsApp and is able to sell some of the products. So a lot of individual entrepreneur desires and greed is also there. Okay, it works. It cuts both ways. So how as a collectives we co-opt and not really stunt the entrepreneurial spirit that is developing also in some of the members. So how do we co-opt and they become part of collectives as like in say in Gambira model. This is one of the dilemmas currently we are facing. So that's going to be an important challenge which we need to address. And as I discussed, we want to work on local cotton and develop our work on the spinning technology so that the farmers and the weavers, we can integrate them the same value chain. And lastly, as far as the business is concerned, how to work on reasonably priced products where we have already consciously worked on affordable products. Most of our products are below 2000 and weavers also wear the products that they weave, which is very important for us. So how do we further work on rationalize and create new product segments like garments, which are below 1000 and 2000? So these are the things with the producers that we are working on. And we'll also be working on starting garmenting or sampling a small enterprise within the collective. So these are the things which we work.
Thanks, Vijaya. I mean, I might even encourage you to share some details about how many of the participants here could pre-order some of your produce and they can, you know, connect with you a bit later.
Yeah, we'll harm them later.
Yeah. So moving over to Naren. Naren, you are part of the RCRC coalition. So you've seen COVID rather close and you continue to be engaged with, you know, relief operations across India. The point essentially is there a certain level of confidence with which we can say that those who are members of collective institutions at various levels have probably been able to respond better to the COVID challenge, both on lives and livelihoods? What's your experience? And of course, you're closest to Delhi. So what are the one or two recommendations you have to the Ministry of Cooperation? Over to you, Naren.
On the first, absolutely, Shambhu, you also given me 3 minutes. So absolutely very true. In fact, as we said, we work on a ecosystem of institutions in a village. So which villages which had a robust panchayats where, you know, there were women's participation and then there was vibrant self-help groups and also high, good quality farmer producer organizations, those villages and those people fared far, far better. I mean, that was very clearly seen in terms of speed of response or in terms of basically holding fort when there was massive distress and hunger, etc. These groups were actually able to reach out to even those who were not in the groups. Especially a lot of in a self-help group system, you have people who are not in self-help groups, who are the very poor people, old people, or maybe differently challenged kind of people. The groups were actually able to reach out to them better. And we were able to talk, because none of us physically, we were also not able to go to the village, but we used to communicate with them regularly through smartphones or normal phones, and help them, you know, pass on the messages about COVID and COVID relief and what one can do, etc. So where there were a good social and economic collectives, their ability to respond and support was much better. And as you know, this was also the cropping season. The first time it hit was in March, so the Rabi crop was there and which had to be marketed. And in a couple of months, they had to plan for the Kharif. And same thing repeated this second wave as well. In both times, there was massive distress because the markets shut down, the vehicles shut down, the produce, which is standing crops, could not be marketed. So again, where there were these collectives were existing, they were able to, one, pay some, you know, slightly better price compared to what they were getting. Otherwise, you know, they were not able to pick up the crops. Even the prices that we're getting in the local markets were so cheap that, let's say, watermelon, which is the cost of production for 3 rupees, they were able to get 1 rupee. So it was, even in the local markets, it was, they weren't going to sell it on a loss. These groups were able to take them, and because of their collectivization aggregation, they were able to take it to slightly farther markets. And in some places, they even hired vehicles and sold directly to the consumer. So, you know, breaking all the middlemen chain. So they were the groups, where these groups were there, they were able to innovate many things and obviously offer better prices to the producers as well. So in terms of the first question was, yeah, hands down, yes. The where there is collectivization and where people had little more wherewithal, which in terms of helping each other through these groups, they fared much, much better. And therefore, so that's again, our increases our faith in the need for such groups and facilitating them. And I think that is what, you know, we'll want to tell the new Ministry of Cooperation as well. Like in the last week, actually, it was quite an interesting week where we had one centralizing Ministry on Cooperation. And the next day, there is a Supreme Court order which decentralized all the cooperatives. So, you know, there's a sort of policy flux right now. But whatever it is, I think the essential elements of cooperation and the cooperative principles of, as we said, you know, protecting the people's space, if that can be done at the state level and the registrar not becoming a, you know, single window demon at the same time, and people becoming far, far more facilitatory and not trying to occupy the space where the community is supposed to be there. If that is the philosophy that people follow, I don't think the, you know, the Ministry of, I think if that is not what is happening. So therefore, if the Ministry of Cooperation, since it is fresh and new, these are the kind of advices it should take. Even though, as Shriram writes in this paper, you know, when certain people enter the enter the scene, you know, a lot of drama or a lot of things start happening. But let's think of the good things. Let us, you know, I hope the cooperative ministry looks at how to facilitate the cooperation, how to enhance the scope for capacity building, skill building, enhance ability of civil society organizations to engage with these collectives in terms of building their internal management systems and, you know, the governance systems, how to protect them in from a policy perspective, so that, you know, they don't get into interference from various, authorities, and also protect them from cutthroat competition from the markets, etc. So basically, the co-op ministry has to start with that basic fundamental faith that, you know, Dr. Kurian had in the cooperatives and in people's power. So that is where I think I would leave it at that level, because currently we do not even know what is going to emerge. But
so Vivek, we now come to you. You know, just to mention to all the participants, we were hoping to go on till 1 o'clock. We thought some of it would go on till 12:30, but I think there have been some very rich conversations. So we may extend for 10 minutes more. Some questions and answers have been answered partially in the chat by the panelists or a few of us. There are many which may not get addressed today, and this is a conversation we've had with the panelists earlier. So we are encouraging the panelists to pick up some of these questions and probably put some of their thoughts together in the form of a blog, because it can remain for the future as well. So my advance apologies to those who feel their questions may not be taken up today. And over to you, Vivek, for your quick response to how the COVID has impacted perhaps the fisheries sector and how cooperatives have been coping with it, and your 1-2 key points on what Amit Shah should be doing in the days to come.
Thank you. The COVID has affected the fishing communities quite a bit. At one level, fish catching, fish production was not strictly banned as such, because it is also part of the primary sector and therefore an essential production, essential commodity. But in practice, fish markets and fishing areas being the proverbial crowded places where every auction is a potential fish auction, is a super spreader event. The tendency has been to curb fishing in a big way. So on and off, there have been huge restrictions on fishing operations. There are districts where people were only allowed to fish for their own consumption, not for sale. There are districts where they adopted rotation fishing. Everybody cannot go out at the same time, so you go in rotation. Once the fish landed, naturally the auction on the beaches and in the fishing harbors is a crowded event. So there's been attempt to have other methods of marketing. So all these has had a lot of disruption, considerable disruption in the lives and the livelihoods of the fishing community, both those who produce the fish and those who sell the fish. The women in particular, because they depend heavily on purchasing the fish in the auctions. Many in area, they have been discouraged. There were times when the Kerala government allowed only large merchants to buy because there won't be any crowding. So a woman wanting one basket of fish and then 10 women surrounding that basket to fight for it in an auction, they discouraged. So yes, it's been a difficult period. But on the other hand, the fishing community is also very resilient. It's not anyway used to daily rewards or regular incomes. It has, in a given year, the daily catches and the incomes wildly fluctuate. The seasonal, between different seasons in a year, the incomes fluctuate. So they have their own mechanisms and coping mechanisms. To a certain extent, the cooperative organizations have helped wherever they have been able to do these collectives. Some of the savings that they have accumulated have been used, various things like that. But on the other hand, I would also say that the fishing community has an important, marine fishing community I'm talking about, has a very important character of self-governance, like tribes. So the cooperative is not even the main institution taking care of the community. The community has its own self-governing institution. Being single caste and comparatively more egalitarian, they have their own systems of managing day-to-day life. So in any disaster situation, forget COVID, COVID was aggravated by at least 3 cyclones, major cyclones in the last many months. So they have a history of coming together, and therefore they have the village community has its own, built up its own some kind of reserves which it uses in such occasions. And they have also ways of this extreme solidarity in which they support. And collectively they go and make their bargaining with the outside world, whether it's the government or the local MLA and things like that. And so I know in many areas, they have got the MLAs to supply ration, they have got the MPs to supply, the political parties to supply. So I think that collective character of the fishing community has been very helpful in this, more than the modern cooperative model. Their customary organizations have played a very big role in the survival of the community during COVID. Now, coming to the new ministry, I would just reiterate what Emmanuel said about the cooperative character of cooperatives. So this is something that we really need to now push. Whatever be the original thoughts, the reasons, and the political reasons behind the formation of the ministry, this is an opportunity once again to talk about cooperatives. I think the positive dimension of the new ministry is that it once again brings cooperatives as a set of institutions to center stage, at least temporarily. And we have an opportunity to argue for what cooperatives are genuinely and what they should be. I think that is the most important part of today's opportunity. We should also push for plurality. The plurality in approaches, plurality in this thing, and there should be some kind of a level playing ground. And this whole state-sponsored cooperative network, some kind of equivalent of the monopoly regulations and monopoly commissioner that we have for corporates, which is not working very well, needs to be thought through, because a small organization of people getting together and running their own business is also sometimes facing a competition with cooperatives which are not cooperatives, which are just state entities masquerading as cooperatives. So some kind of a lot of thought has to be given about these parastatals which are masquerading as cooperatives. How do we look at them? Of course, the Max Act time is all nicely, conceptualized as public service cooperatives, where government has locked an intervention, investment. They are a class in themselves and they need a different approach. Genuine cooperatives where people put their own money and manage their own affairs. That is where the whole Max thing came. Max has been mostly killed on the states. And ironically, it is the amendment to the Constitution to emphasize that the cooperative comes from Article 19, the freedom of association, and rather than the statute of the Cooperative Act. That was the whole intention of that amendment, but that's been completely forgotten and it has gone into some various other routes it has taken, and now the Supreme Court judgment also complicates matters. We really do not know where we stand on this, but the reality is cooperatives should be the people's own organization and encouraged as such. And the plurality in approaches, the Conventional Cooperative Act, which is also further democratized to the extent possible, the Max Act should be encouraged, because that's the only way the state governments can still provide a platform for genuine cooperatives. And the producer companies also need to continue to have the independence. And there, some of the dangers that comes in now, because there is a new ministry, is where will the producer company chapter go? Let us all recall that the producer company chapter was dropped by the Rusi Modi committee when the new cooperative, the Companies Act was formulated. But then the cooperative people went and said, what happened? Well, how can you drop this? Then the government said, yes, for the time being, we are leaving it with the Companies Act because there's no alternative, but eventually we'll make an independent act. Now, this could be the danger point. That's if we have an independent act, it could very well be that of the Ministry of Cooperation. That's where it's going to go. So I still say that the government should provide Ram Rajya rather than Dhritarashtra's embrace. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Vivek. I think just to remind many of our participants that, in 2013, there was a discussion at IRMA on the 97th Amendment, and probably a good time again for us to think about that as a separate theme after we get more clarity on the recent Supreme Court judgment. So before I leave Balu with the closing words, just a few points. The first is, I think, Professor Pepin, you wanted to share something in a minute. Are you still there? Or Nagendranath ji, we are really looking forward to actually having a separate... Yes, Pepin, go ahead.
Yes. First of all, I would like to congratulate all the panelists. for the inspiring, you know, sharing. It was very, very inspiring, and we have learned a lot. I just have one question to Mr. Vivekanandan, whom we all very dearly revere as one of the leaders among the fishermen community with a clean heart and a clean hand. You know, that is how he has been seen. Vivek, just a small question to you. You know, of okay. late, the government of India is, you know, planning to what you call create a greenfield port and a container shipment hub in Kanyakumari. There has been a lot of you know, discernment and, you know, dissatisfaction among our people in that area. If that comes up, I am told that there will be a lot of displacement, both the fishing and the non-fishing you know, villages. So have you ever thought of it, you know, what can be done to avoid this? Because that is going to affect the livelihood of thousands of fishermen.
You are right. In fact, there are two types of displacement sticking. One is the creeping one. On a daily basis, various things are happening where fishermen are losing access to the coast. Marine fishermen have two types of CPRs. One, the sea where they do their livelihood, the fishing, and two, the coast where they reside. And they don't have rights on both, legal rights. So we are, you know, also part of that, and we are certainly arguing for something like a fisher's rights bill on the lines of the Forest Rights Act, which gives, which recognizes the historical right of some of these community to the coast and the sea. And that is a very important thing. And unless they have the free, prior, informed consent for any project coming on the coast or in the near sea waters, near shore waters, it is going to be very difficult to protect their livelihoods. So there are legal issues, legal instruments, which we are also seeking. But on the other hand, at least fortunately, so far the Kanyakumari community was united across the entire coast, the 68 kilometer coastline, 25,000-30,000 seagoing, 40,000 seagoing fishermen, they were all united and they have blocked that port. And state politics as of now is in their favor. And that is why they have been able to keep the big wolf out. But like in Kudankulam, when the state itself was not entirely genuinely on the side of the fishermen, we could not keep out the big wolf. So at the moment, the situation in Kanyakumari is that it is not very easy for the government to impose any greenfield port on the fishermen. But this is a problem not of just Kanyakumari fishermen, but the entire 6,000 kilometer of the Indian coastal peninsula, and the very ambitious schemes, which come also through geopolitics. So some of the problems that we are facing are not easy to resolve because the geopolitics involved. Because the competition with China to control the Indian Ocean is one of the driving forces for every 20 kilometers the government wants a port, which will completely wipe out fishing, spoil our whole ecosystem on the coast. There will be very few beaches left even for the city people to, or all of us to go and enjoy. So that's the reality. And thank you for that question.
Thanks a lot, Vivek. Nagendranath ji, would you like to share something? Because we really look forward to having a separate discussion on SFG-related collective institutions, and we hope you will be able to join us. We will be in touch with you on this. But would you like to share something, if you would like to? I think we have one or two more people who've raised their hand. Indumati and Bhavna, please type your question. I'm afraid we are really running short on time. It's been 2 hours plus, and we will be able to share your questions with the panelists and get back a bit later as well. Before I, you know, hand it over to Balu Iyer to kind of conclude and summarize, I just also want to share with you that as part of the Kurien centenary celebrations, we are planning, I mean, we're very happy to have this collaboration with the ICA and the Domus Trust. So there is a young research track, special track on cooperatives. This will not be restricted only to doctoral students. Practitioners and others also below the age of 35 can participate in this, and we will try and reach out to you all a bit later. And I will also share the email ID of the Kurien Centenary. So any suggestions that you have for ways to go forward, please feel free to get in touch with us. And I'm really sorry that we are not able to take up some of those questions now, but I would like to hand it over to Balu Iyer to, you know, thank the panelists and also have a few concluding thoughts. Over to you, okay. Balu.
Thank you, Professor Shambhu. Thank you for also mentioning about the track during the DocMed thing. That's one way in which we are trying to promote young researchers to look into cooperatives and collectives. And from July, again, just as information, from July 27th to 29th, we are having the online Asia-Pacific Cooperative Youth Summit. We'll post the link here. And as part of this, we are trying to encourage young people to come up. We have something called the co-op pitch, where we are asking young people to pitch their ideas about what kind of cooperative they would like to form. So this is a competition. We've had a good response. And Amul is sponsoring the prizes this time. So this is again just as information. Let me thank everyone who has joined this webinar to celebrate the centenary of Dr. Verghese Kurien and honor his work. I'd like to thank our panelists, Vijaya Swetha, Vivekanandan, Emmanuel Murray, and Damodaran Narendranath. It feels strange. Damu is what I'm used to calling him, for championing Dr. Kurien's ideals, putting it into practice and continuing to battle the odds. I think in a country like India, it's not easy given the structure of our society, the influence of politics, the assertions of bureaucracy that we've heard about. So I think hats off to you all for battling and championing and holding high the cooperative and collective flag. As we've heard, cooperatives and collectives are more relevant than before, given the impact of the we've seen on farmers, informal workers, women, migrant workers, and in the services and the social sector. The trajectory of decreasing poverty, which we were seeing for a number of years, is again reversing. Post-pandemic, we are going to see, it's still not post-pandemic. The pandemic, as far as I see, continues. We've had the first wave, the second wave, we're anticipating the third wave. And so what's happening is that the world is failing to tackle poverty. The economy is rapidly changing, leaving behind a majority of people. And we've seen also that inequality in all its form is widening, be it in terms of income, health, vaccination is a good example of that. Education, it's very easy to say we moved online, but then how many of the real poor people have access to the internet and have been moved online? So I think inequality in all its form is widening. And we all know that free markets by themselves will not automatically deliver prosperity. And I think this is where the role of cooperatives and collectives, I'm very heartened to see that you all have, all of you all have said that there is no doubt that cooperatives and collectives are relevant and continue to be relevant. We just need to see how we continue to promote, get these new dimension in, bring in the younger population with whom we see that the cooperative values and principles can resonate. So I thank you all for making this point about the importance and relevance of cooperatives in the current time and moving ahead. Let me thank Director Umakant Das for joining us. Thank Professor Shambhu for and staff for organizing this webinar and inviting the ICAP to be part of this webinar. During the recent days, it's also been talked about the recent Ministry of Cooperation and the Supreme Court verdict on the 97th Amendment. And Professor Shambhu, you mentioned that early on there was a discussion in IRMA about the 97th Amendment. And I see at ICA, we would like to see how we can collaborate, how we can put in, get these ideas, more of these ideas, and see how we can put it, the views, not just from the politicians. We've seen in the past few days, politicians lining up to congratulate the new minister and the ministry, but we've not seen practitioners go up and congratulate. We've not seen people from the field put forth their ideas. And I think I see that as an opportunity for us to see how we can put our heads together and put these points which have been shared in front of the ministry for whatever it's worth. I think they need to hear these viewpoints. And if I also may add, I think the centenary of Dr. Kurien is also the opportunity to restart the campaign to award him the Bharat Ratna. I think this has been talked before, but I think if there is anyone who deserves, he deserves it. And can we again see how we can restart to ensure that we bring this also as part of Irma's campaign, as part of the centenary campaign, to create a movement around that. I'd like to thank Mohit and Shivali, my colleagues, and Shri for organizing, bringing us all together. So thank you all. And also Mr. Shivansh Mishra, Manager Communication at IRMA, for their active promotion. I think we had over 350 registrations from 10 countries. And this is a testimony to the outreach which has been done. And thanks a lot to everyone for joining us and actively participating in the webinar. I had this line, I didn't know whether I should say that, but I'll still go ahead and say it. And this is a line from which the actor Ajit has been often quote, ki ise liquid oxygen mein dal do. Ise liquid ise jeene nahi dega and oxygen ise marne nahi dega. And for those who are not familiar with Hindi, it says that let's put him in liquid oxygen. The liquid won't let him live and the oxygen won't let him, no, the liquid won't let him survive and the oxygen won't let him live or something around that. But I think that's where I see cooperatives are. We are in a limbo. It's neither pulled out and said, okay, we are done with it, or we are not reviving it. So how do we remove cooperatives out of this liquid oxygen is something which we all need to think and contemplate about. And again, if I may add a line to the ministry, as Dr. Kurien said, any sensible government, and for me now it's the Ministry of Cooperation, must learn to unleash the energy of its people and get them to perform instead of trying to get a bureaucracy to perform. And I saw this is only time will tell whether this will happen or not. But till then, let's take care, stay safe. And thank you very much for joining us in this webinar. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Balu. Just a final word to one of the questions raised. The webinar will be available on YouTube possibly in a few days after a bit of editing or any requirement. And please feel free to send your suggestions on the Kurien centenary. And some of the institutions that are here, Madras School of Social Work, we've not been able to hear you, but we would like each institution to work in such a collaborative manner so that we can have these events across the country. And please write to us on ways to take it further. Thank you all. Thanks a lot to the panelists, to the director, Nagendranath ji, and others.
Thank you. Bye-bye, everyone.
Thank you.